who is our avatar for this meetup. So the Emperor, you'll see him. You can show yours at the same time. That's the cool thing about this 360-degree camera.
Which way do I look?
Right? Whichever way you want.
At least, no, now we're doing it in front and the back?
Yeah, why not? Just curl around. Oh my gosh, this is so cool.
Be like a carousel up above and just have it rotate.
So rad. Stately and commanding, the Emperor knows who he is and what he wants and is surrounded by ram's heads to symbolize Aries and Mars. He carries an Ankh in one hand and a globe in the other, symbolic of power over darkness and his dominion over the earth. He sits in an easy, relaxed position, yet wears his armor under his cloak, indicating he's always ready to do battle should the need arise. The bare mountains behind him represent his unyielding power. He represents lordship of thought and reason over emotions in the subconscious. He has a strong masculine principle, authority, fatherhood, and leadership, ambition, and management of affairs. I think when I was looking this up earlier today, I was thinking about Saturn, because Saturn is very much the disciplinarian of the zodiac. But in this case with the Emperor, it has some more to do with Mars, which is the war-making. But he's also very powerful, and he has to do with immediate action. So I think if you're thinking in terms of astrological influences, it seems like it's very much somewhere between Saturn and Mars, because Saturn generally has to do with rules and, you know, the systems of that we live under, like political systems, the military systems, governments, all of that kind of crap. But Mars is this war-making power, and generally Mars is an immediacy. He is the car, or the god of immediate action.
I'd probably tend to go more with your first thought, because to me, when I look at the Emperor, he's not wielding a sword. He's not in any way...
Yeah, in
prepared
this card.
For war. In
show that
card.
One, man. Show the camera.
It's very much...
He's chilling.
He's chilling. He's got his armor. He's prepared for war, should it come. And yes. He's thoughtful and meditative. And I think he represents power and strength and stability. But he's not brandishing boldly, going out with the sword pointed away, charging and attacking. He's the one that's ready.
Yeah, he doesn't need to.
Exactly.
So that's... Yeah, because a lot of the times, if you are powerful, you don't need to show it all the time. It's like, I think I saw on Dr. Phil once, he said, someone said, well, I demand respect. Well, there's a difference between commanding respect and demanding respect, right? And the Emperor commands respect. Like I love this... the Tarot Illuminati, he's just so relaxed. He's like, I've got my shit. He doesn't even wield a sword. He has a scepter. You know, like, how much more powerful can you get?
You want to see the science card?
Yeah, you know it.
Yeah, so. It's interesting. It's called crystallization, and it has a picture of sugar being crystallized.
Oh,
so
wow.
Did that grow up in school.
Yeah. So it has the experiment most of us did in school, where you supersaturate a sugar solution, and then you dip a stick in, and it goes like, yeah. And it says, the Emperor represents the power to form a precisely ordered structure from a shapeless mass of disconnected parts. Ultimately, this power is found within each of us, uniting our scattered energies toward a common purpose, and offering a brilliant example to inspire the world.
And different solutions and bases, like materials, those supersaturated solutions, form into different shapes.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, it's all very organized.
It's all still a super ordered, highly precise. Yeah.
God, that deck of cards is so cool.
Yeah, it's an interesting interpretation of the Emperor for sure.
God, that's really cool. Oh. All right, what else have we got here? The will to take control, exclusion of personal feelings when dealing with important matters, even love. Can indicate power tripping and egocentrism, forcefulness, stubbornness and always wanting things your way. Because every card has a positive and a negative aspect.
Which is very true in the crystallization thing, too. I mean, you line up in the crystal, right? Like,
yeah.
Otherwise, you're not part of it.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything said of it, like in this card in particular, actually shows the sheep's and lamb's heads are actually part of the throne?
Oh, yeah, he's
like,
chilling
these
on
look
sheep.
More like sheep, and these look like rams with the big curved horns.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, like, sheep and ram are almost like innocents.
Well, the ram's not
be,
so much.
Some of them can be strong, but at the end of the day, he's resting on a throne on top of them.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything to that?
Well, the ram, I don't know about...
It's definitely a curved horn.
Yeah, I don't know about...
It's interesting that they're definitely sheep, because they're all definitely rams in the
mm-hmm.
in the Rider Waite.
Yeah, and the ram itself is... the ram is the symbol for Aries, the zodiac sign. And that's ruled by Mars.
Yeah. And the ram is more strength and stability than the sheep. That's kind of throwing me off.
Yeah, I'm not really sure with that particular deck what their interpretation is. It's something like, I'd have to look it up. But maybe that symbolizes his power over the common men? You know, over the commoners?
Form of leadership and community and respect.
Mm-hmm. And like, I think you were saying it, Eric, with your deck, is the inspiration. Like, he's the kind of guy that inspires loyalty out of his subjects. You know what I mean? He doesn't have to threaten them. Like, if you have a ruler that's running around threatening people, how valid is his power?
Yeah. I mean, the crystallization interpretation, like, crystals form matter. The particles actually self-assemble into shape.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, you don't have to crack a whip. It's just...
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, when conditions are right, everything, like, aligns.
Mm-hmm. And, like, that actually speaks to self-discipline. Because when you are disciplined, and you have your mind over matter, intelligence over passion, then you can do anything. Like, not to brag or nothing, but just over 2 years ago, I quit drinking. And that was all a matter of self-discipline and mind over matter. Like, it's probably, like, and I've accomplished a lot of things, but I think that is probably one of my most proud accomplishments, or one of the accomplishments I'm most proud of, just because it, like, you really got to dissociate from the everyday way of thinking that, you know, we're trained into. You know, commercials bombard us with images about drinking and, oh, be the cool guy, be the bro, get the bikini girls, or unwind after a long day of work, have a glass of wine. And, you know, you really have to be self-disciplined and stay the course and apply steady force just to maintain.
And temptations all around, because even before I knew that was something that was important to you, I was offering you the milkshakes, for example.
Man. And you know...
Temptations are everywhere, dude.
Oh, right? And milkshakes are a double whammy for me since I got caught the lactose intolerance. But how good are milkshakes? How good are milkshakes? Let's see. Solving conflict through power. I like that concept. We were just discussing that about, you know, like, when you do wield actual power, you can solve conflicts and not, you know, not resort to violence. It's just strength and power and violence are not necessarily the same thing. Balance is only disturbed when one is not in tune with the necessary order of things. That's actually a quote I attributed to him, so don't worry, guys. I'm only slightly played around. He's the archetypal father, a good provider, but uncomfortable with emotional displays. Represents structure, organization, and playing by the rules is the best way to get ahead. And not, you can't, like, that's not something I would say applies to all of life, but when he shows up in your reading, you know, don't cut corners, you know, don't try to game the system, don't try to, you know, tweak things, just, you know, play it straight, and keep steady, and that's your best bet in those circumstances. Because generally, I hate rules, and I hate order, and I am not forming a crystal. It can indicate an encounter with someone involved in the law or government, police, lawyer, governor, city councilor, something like that. Someone involved in the system, of order in the society. The pragmatic approach to life is apt to succeed at that point when you see the emperor, working within limitations that are imposed by others or yourself. It can be trouble understanding concepts that can't be seen, very show me, don't tell me, very practical. In romance, like I was reading on this, the one site, it was saying that, when a woman approaches the emperor and says, I need more from you in our relationship, I need you to be more emotionally there, he's like, he goes and buys her earrings. Because he doesn't know, he's not going to write you a poem, he's not going to sing you a song, he's not going to, go out and get flowers, he's like, you're the man, the typical man. It indicates war-making power and how to use it, the knowledge of how to use it, self-mastery, responsibility, structural order, laws. And the magician and high priestess are like the potential energy versions of the active energy of the emperor and empress. So the magician is the spark of creation, and the emperor is actually going out and doing it. And the high priestess is the potential of inner wisdom and creativity, but the empress is the actual creative. So that is the workshop.
Pretty cool.
Yeah. That's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
So, some a little side or off with it. There's been some conversations that I've been having recently with various groups around masculinity and that. And these concepts are very, very solidly bound for a very long time. And I think just recently,
It is a very popular conversation, at least in social media right now. It's a narrative like questioning gender identity and typical ideas, concepts of masculine and feminine. And I don't mean to insult anybody, but when I say typical masculine energy, that's,
I wasn't quite referring to that. I'm just kind of interested in seeing. Because, yes, typically it was, and when these decks were first made, it was very much what was expected of them.
Yeah, the very rigid general.
Yeah, very extreme one way or another. I'd be curious to see how interpretations of the deck and considerations evolve as potentially our views towards masculinity.
I mean, in some sense, I don't think they would need to evolve it because the deck already represents all aspects, right? Like, you still, even if you reinterpret or don't think it's as valuable as it used to be, you still need a masculine card.
Oh, absolutely. I'm not saying that masculine would be removed. I'm saying that the interpretation of how you see it, it doesn't necessarily have to be emotionless, for example, right?
Yeah. I mean, I agree. You could have some kind of emotionally masculine card.
Well, this is more like the cowboy card.
Yeah.
The silent. Yeah, like it's very much the cowboy card, the sheriff of that town. The sheriff and then their parts, with the spurs and very quiet and, Clint Eastwood with a stub of his cigarillo.
Very true.
The quiet power. He's not going to pick a fight, but he's going to, you pick a fight with him, he's going to win.
Very much so.
Yeah. And I think, I was telling someone earlier today that very recently I was, uh, I, I was told that I was a misogynist, and I was told that oh God, just a woman hater, and I had internalized sexist thoughts. And I thought that was really funny because, like, my whole life I just live it as a poem to feminism, like, and to busting gender roles and to, you know, like, reinterpreting what we look at as feminine and what we call feminine. Coming from that point of view, and wielding the kind of power that the emperor wields, I think would be very interesting. Like, what if the emperor was reinterpreted as a female? You know what I mean? What could we say about her? You know, if the emperor, if we swapped gender roles on the emperor and she walked into a boardroom, I don't think she would command the same type of respect. You would have, like, a room full of dudes trying to undermine her at every opportunity, and I think she would have a hard go of things, whereas an emperor would have the kingdom bowing to her.
Yeah. Unfortunately, right now, that is currently where we are.
Yeah.
And that's why I think it's a long way to go before there's even a softening consideration to the masculine side.
Yeah. And,
but,
and there is, like, a whole different concept. I'm back on. There's a note on the door.
I'd be curious how, say, maybe 100 years ago, people looked at tarot and interpreted simple cards compared to today and how it's kind of evolved based on community and culture and everything around us.
You're welcome
you can
totally
come and
dinner.
Join us, by the way.
Yeah, you're welcome.
My bike, someone. It's not a man. It's
your,
on public. Yeah.
Your bike is now mine.
Are your bikes making out in public? Alright, so I guess on that note, we can just wrap it up. This was a really great discussion, and yeah, this was really nice. Thank you. Thank you guys for coming. And thank you for tuning in. One person
on
Facebook
who
made it this
way.
Well, there's been two or three sometimes.
Here and there, but that's just the live stream. You can also tune in and catch our past episodes. I'm thinking I might start to download these and pop them on a YouTube or something, just so we can compile them. But otherwise, thank you so much for the 360-degree 3D. Like, that's going to be so great.
It gives me a chance to practice my skills, and it's great to be a part of the group.
Oh, amazing.
Be able to share it.
So. And so, once again, we're in downtown Toronto. We meet once a month at Hack Lab at 1266 Queen Street West. No, I was just, I'm getting ahead of myself and thinking, okay, what am I going to say next? You can find us online at www.hacklab.to. That's HACKLAB.TO. And the group is Familiar, a tarot study group. And tell your friends, come down. You know, we do it once a month, and we're learning all 78 cards, five at a time. And I guess I should have maybe done the temperance card as well and gone, you know, done the double digits, but we'll figure out something.
Yeah, like when we get up to 10, then we're in trouble on the major arcana, right? But
we'll figure something out. All right. Have a great night, everyone, and thanks for getting familiar with us. Cool
beans.
Thanks, Joseph.
Live stream, decently smooth. At some point, I actually need to look at the video while I'm doing the recording online.
I didn't see any video.
Yeah, separate connection. So I was seeing it glancing on the phone here, and
okay.
I did jump online a couple of times.
Okay, cool.
I'm thinking people definitely did. And of course, it's also being able to go back afterwards and be able to look around and explore it too. So, pretty cool.
Oh, I didn't see half of these. Thomas, yeah.
Yeah, my mistake was I went to invite my friend Sarah Stimson and said, it was like, oh, comment, Sarah Stimson. It's like, delete.
No. That's rad, though. We got 9 shares.
That's awesome.
But I was like, yeah, I guess there's no delete.
Committed now forever.
Oh, Gabrielle had our backs. Wow, man. Thank you, Gabrielle. That is really awesome.
What did she say?
She shared it like 1,000 times,
oh,
man.
I see.
Reconnecting. He's probably reconnecting. Duh. Done, I tell you.